through there by doing this. And I believe there's going to be a very, very hard look at what the definition of a non-profit or not-for-profit
Is that okay? And if that
that decision is made, does that mean if they're in an automobile accident, when they go to the emergency room, they don't receive care because they made that decision? I mean, these are the questions that we deal with. And, sir, with great failing, I don't have a perfect answer for you. I really don't. I mean, I don't have all the answers. That's one of the reasons I stand here and try to listen to all points of view. If I had a perfect solution, I'd be championing that exact line that they have to walk to balance the two.
I feel as a we have a young family, a 2- and 1-year-old, and a tremendous burden on me and my wife. Not just to take care of our own family, but the feeling that we are taking care of those, we're taking on additional responsibilities that I don't want.
You didn't sign up. I agree.
I don't want that responsibility.
So first let me just reflect something you said. Thank you for participating. Many, many people have come to me and said, I've never gone to a town hall meeting. I've never even talked to a member of Congress. We today are seeing not fabricated emotions, but very real emotions. There's nothing pre-fabricated by anybody in this room. And I've come to understand and have great appreciation and respect for that. Part of my job is to try to incorporate all of these inputs. And sir, you've stood with many who have said the same thing in almost the same words or different words to me. And then try to figure out in that cacophony of input, how do you distill it down and represent it as it deserves to be represented? And that's the tough part of this job. It really is. I don't negate what you say. I take what you say from the heart, that you've said it to me from the heart, and I'll do my very, very best to transmit it. That's as good as I can do. Next question, please.
Look, this has got to be a little bit of a debate. That's what democracy is about. For the clarification of the people here, we need to understand on what legal basis is health care a right?
Okay, so the question is on what legal basis health care is a right. And when I ask that question to find out why is the federal government even discussing health care, it all goes back to what we talked about in the Constitution. That is, the issue of the general welfare. That's why it's been like that. So when people see things in the Constitution in the way it's been interpreted, they don't like it, they boo it. When they see things that they do like and they want to stand up, they fight for it. But I don't have to tell you very clearly, I don't get to pick and choose. I don't get to interpret the Constitution. He's saying, where is the legal authority?
Individual wealth.
If you don't clap, I can make more points. Cost is a huge driver, and none of the plans that either the Congress or the Senate has spent so much time shaping do anything to bend the cost curve down. None of them. This plan doesn't, in my view, do anything significant on that score. What we need is a robust public option, short of single payer, which, as you've said, is probably off the table. These exchanges, unless they are pre-populated with a large number of people, the way Medicare was automatically pre-populated with many millions of 65 and over people, are really not going to do anything. And the history of options, the California healthcare exchange failed after several years. So I think there's ample data to support that what's in this bill will not work. Okay, so there are many, many reasons to be against it. My question to you has to do with two aspects of the legislative process in the Senate and in Congress. One, do you foresee the Senate Democrats acceding to reality of the fact that no Republican votes will come for any significant health care reform and just deciding to go it alone for the 51 that the non-filibuster option will give them? And two, what is your reading of the tea leaves on votes in the House for any proposal that has a robust
go along? You said that over and over again. I just have to take it at the word. I think we can't get something bipartisan, we won't get anything. So that's the answer to one. As far as the votes in the House are concerned, I know today, as we stand here, the votes to pass this bill don't exist. And I'm one of them. So some people have said to me, other people have said to me, I'm glad you're voting against it, but you're voting against it for the wrong reasons. Other people have said, you have the wrong reasons, but I don't like the way you think. And in the end of the day, I only get two options, yes or no. That's all I get at the end of the day. And if the votes had been there, instead of a whole bunch of freshman members and others, you know, the Washington newspapers wrote up a newspaper, they called me, I think someone told me, a rogue Democrat. They said that I was the most independent member of the freshman class. And they looked at the numbers, and it's like, out of 17 times that the president's had a vote, I voted against it 8 times, and that is like a record. I don't think the votes are in the House of Representatives today to pass this. In fact, I don't think we're going to take a vote on this, on anything in healthcare, until at the earliest, December. And for those of you who watch how things work, you get in December, pretty quickly it becomes January. And then you're into a whole new year cycle. So, sir, I don't have the keys. That's as direct as an answer as I can give
you. Thank you, Dr. I have just a few comments. I'll try to be very brief. First of all, I'm for single payer as you are.
Policies to part of the 10th Amendment, and that's what's determined through elections, and that's how policy changes. And that's what I've learned and what's been taught to me. I hope that answers your question.
First of all, thank you for holding this meeting. I appreciate your courage and your candor. This is a tough room. And your remarks have been very informative, and you started to answer my question a little earlier. But my wife and I are 67. We've worked our entire adult lives. And like you, I've served our country in wartime. We both retired last year, although I'm still working part-time. We paid into Social Security since we started working, and into Medicare since its inception. I'm still paying the both. We understand that President Obama plans to fund the universal health care by taking money out of Medicare, and that we have money out of Medicare, money that we and others pay in. And in doing so, we plan to eliminate the Medicare Advantage program that we and so many other seniors rely upon. We don't think this is fair. Do you?
No. So, I'm afraid to tell you that this bill, which represents the administration's focus at this time, is going to take money out of Medicare. What that means is going back to that statement we said about savings, where those payments to providers are reduced. That's the actual action of taking money out of Medicare, which will force an awful lot of seniors and retirees to potentially have to increase payments to private health insurance companies for more Medicare supplemental policies. That's the insidious circle that is not beneficiary. By the way, sir, I can't see, but what ribbon are you wearing on your lapel?
It's the Silver Star.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I don't know if you realize what that means. Warrior. It went hot a couple times in Beirut and Desert Storm Bosnia.
Washington is writing checks that we can't pay. The people did not want the stimulus package, yet it passed. And we're supposed to believe, oh, the economy would have been so much worse if it had not passed. Really? As to health care, when I heard President Obama wanted the military to buy their own private insurance so that the government would not be responsible for the expense of their war injuries, I was appalled.
Can I help with that? I just need to jump in on that.
Sure.
Because I was in the room. Here's what happened. This is how things get spun out of control. The president created a requirement that we figure out how many veterans we have in this country because we don't know right now. We really don't. And then the question was asked of those veterans who we know of, how many of them have private health insurance? And that number was tried to be established. Not perfect, but it was the first time we ever looked at that. The next question was of those people who are veterans, who have private health insurance and receive VA benefits, how many of those VA benefits should have been paid by private health insurers? We have a system in this country today called secondary payment, where if you have a primary provider and you go to a hospital or you go to the VA and you're covered under a secondary payer, they're supposed to pay. And the private health insurance industry has been ripping off veterans for I don't know how long by forcing them to go to the VA, forcing the VA to pay for it, when in fact those premiums should have covered that condition. At no time, and I was in the room, did anyone suggest, nor did the president or his administration require, that veterans take out private health insurance.
Thank you.
That whole issue has become so clouded. The idea actually was to say, wait a minute, you're a military retiree, or you're a long-serving veteran, and you have taken out a private health insurance policy, now you're too sick. And you go see them, or you go to the VA, and they take care of you, and the VA is not reimbursed by what the contract with the private insurer says it should have been. That's what the debate was about. It was about a $590 million question. Now, I know $590 in today's numbers doesn't seem like a lot, but it's a huge amount of money. And that's what the debate was about. And I just had to clarify that.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I don't want the government in my health care decisions, and I don't want to wait to see a specialist. If you would have had to wait to have your cancer treated, perhaps we would have lost you.
No, I would have died. There's no doubt about it.
Please do not vote for health care reform we can't afford and don't want. Please vote for what we do need. Keep America strong. Keep her safe. And let's try and make her solvent again. I do agree, we need change. We need to be physically responsive with that change.
I too appreciate your coming into the lion's den. I don't want to take up too much time on that, but I don't want to offend anyone by saying ghetto. My number was actually given to my good friend here in her 80s, and she wanted to make sure I pointed out that seniors are very concerned that illegal immigrants are getting promises of health care on the backs and that money's being taken away from senior citizens. She's probably going to be upset with me because my point is actually the opposite of hers. But fortunately, I know. I think we need to change the debate. I'm concerned that we won't be able to, though. The questions about whether health care is a right, amend the Constitution to fix them. If, personally, I think eating is more important than health care. I may need health care, but I'm really going to eat food, so why doesn't the government just feed me and I'll stay home? The real problem has been, I really do appreciate, I've come to respect you an awful lot, seeing how you respond and the good ideas that you had and wanting to kill this bill, those are all wonderful things. But underlying it all is an assumption that the government should be involved in these things. And I was interested to hear your interpretation of the welfare clause because that's very different from the way FDR interpreted the commerce clause, that third clause in section. Part of what's going on here tonight, the anger, and I studied people a long time to understand that anger often does come from fear. and the fear that our founding fathers had of the powers of government caused them clauses. And FDR didn't like the way the Supreme Court was saying, no, you can only do certain things in Congress and the states get to do the rest. And it's history that he packed the court. We've got, he packed it, and they gave the answers that he wanted. And so since then, our government has changed to not, how can we limit the awful power, I believe our brother called it the fire, of the government. And how do we make sure that we live free? And I think a lot of the scariness, I'm really glad to hear you say, let's bite off a piece at a time rather than the whole apple. Because the bill as it stands represents to so many people a huge power grab. I'd like to just change the argument because it seems to represent it so often. And I'm glad I did not hear you say that once tonight, that you're so proud of you bringing home the bacon. Everybody wants to bring home the bacon, forgetting that we're the pig.
What has been decided on? I mean, restriction of the general welfare clause, and there are a lot of very specific restrictions in the Constitution that cannot be crossed over. I don't have a perfect answer to your question. All I can do is integrate your concerns and try to reflect. Next question.
Thank you for being here tonight. We appreciate it. I think the American people are angry and fearful because they don't feel that they're hearing the truth.
Thank you.
I think that we understand that entitlements are wonderful, are meant to be compassionate and help people. But like most Ponzi schemes, if you get in the beginning, you're in good shape, and as they go on, they go broke. I don't think there's any doubt that they claim that Medicare will start spending more out than take in by 2014. Medicaid even sooner, and Social Security is in real trouble because more is being paid out that is being taken in. And I think that's what happens regardless of what political party is in power. So if truth could be said to the American people, I think we could come to something that could take care of our Medicare problem and also fix this thing so that it's more fair and understandable. Every bill so far has billions of dollars coming out of Medicare and claiming that this can be done by perceived savings. So tell me how you plan to take out in the Senate bill $550 billion at a time when the baby boomers are getting on Medicare. Where will the money come from to take care of these people without cutting and rationing our benefits?
It won't, which is one of the reasons I'm not going to vote for the bill.
Why is all this propaganda out there that everybody is going to have quality health care? Everybody. When we know that we are going to start being rationed because of the dollars we know it. So why not say the truth? And then people maybe can come to a sensible conclusion.
I can be and want to be held totally and completely accountable for anything I say and do. I have no control over, as you use the words, what the broad propaganda is. Can't even begin to speak to that. But I did look at this audience about 2 hours ago and said, we are going to have very difficult choices as a nation, and no one is going to like what they are. I don't know how to be more plain spoken or more direct than that.
Good evening, Congressman Massa. I'm one of those people who chose not to have health insurance. I heard some people here who mentioned that option. Did that for 12 years, but not because I didn't want it, because I was a working single mother and I couldn't afford private insurance, but at the same time I couldn't get Medicaid either. And so far tonight, I've heard a lot of people screaming at the congressman and criticizing and throwing out misinformation and insults. But I haven't heard anyone actually share some stories. I'm going to share with you a true story. It's not from a script, from the internet, or talk radio. This is an actual experience. And I think it's very meaningful tonight because in 2005 or so, when you were first campaigning for Congress, I shared this story with you. I don't know if you remember. Actually, a couple of times. And at that point, you really didn't have a position, a clear position on the healthcare reform. And so I want to tell you how much I appreciate the position and the stance that you've taken. So for 12 years, I didn't have healthcare. I'm a single parent. And I actually have it now. because I'm a teacher and I've had it for about 2 years. But at the same time, just because I have it doesn't mean that I don't want anyone else to have it. There are a lot of people here who care only about themselves. I care about all Americans. I care about 47 million or so uninsured Americans. I want them to have what I have. My congressmen to get that. I don't think that the government is this nefarious entity. We are the government, and if we have health care reform and a bill, we will fight. We fight for it because it's not. I'm not relying on the government. I'm a citizen. And
but I do need to get to the.
Okay, just a comment. I'm not even asking a question.
Okay.
And the last point I want to make as far as being someone who is uninsured is that when you are insured, you have a relationship with your doctor. And I didn't have that for a long time, and that's an important part of health care. And so that's just my comment, and I want to support you in continuing your work with this, and thank you very much.
Thank you for coming out here. I appreciate that you're voting against this bill. What worries me is that the next time around we make the same gift in a different bracket. So I'm going to use this current bill that you're voting against as reference for where my concern comes from. In page 17, the grace period for current employment-based health plans. First paragraph reads, at the end of the five-year period, beginning with year one, employment-based health plan in operation as of the date of the first day of year one must meet the same requirements as applied to qualified health benefits. We then skip to, as this I believe was mentioned earlier on page 167, those who do not meet the requirements are hereby imposed a tax equal to 2.5% in excess of the taxpayer's modified adjusted gross income over the taxable year and specified section, blah, blah, blah. The tax imposed shall not exceed the applicable national average premium. That does not seem like any kind of competition. That does not seem like it's free market economics.
What was the second page you mentioned?
167 and 168.
Okay.
I love the idea of being able to, you know, have competing health insurance from outside of state lines, as they will be then competing for my dollar. But looking at what's in this bill and what I fear may come in subsequent bills, is that they really won't be competing. They're all going to be the same plan. Can you give me any assurance that it will be true competition? And not clones of whatever plan is coming from the government. And for those of us who aren't on that plan, why do we have to be taxed into compliance with said government plan?
One of the very first things that was said about healthcare reform during the last campaign season was that it would be paid for, it would be deficit neutral, by rolling back the tax cuts in the Bush years to the last year of the Reagan tax code. That was kind of what was said, that the last year of the rate of tax code. Many people said, well, you know, all right, that kind of sounds fair. People like me and many others started getting very worried when we started hearing about the fact that we would start seeing surcharges. And that in Congress is the first time a lot of members stood up and said, wait a second, you know, teacher time out. And that speaks to your question about the surcharge. It also speaks to the question of what do you do with someone who can, but who opts out of the system, and then says, I'm not going to have health insurance, and incurs potential tremendous costs either because of a cataclysmic illness or a tremendous accident. And that goes back to the whole conversation we had about, there's no perfect answer to that, there's a great deal of debate going on. I just want to mention something on what you said about page 17. So page 17 is part of an overall section whose title is Protecting the Choice to Keep Current Coverage, which was one of the commitments that was made about any bill that we move forward. If you have what you have and you like what you have, you'll be able to keep what you have. And this whole section speaks to that. And the paragraph that you quoted that says the five-year period means that nothing can change for a minimum of those first 5 years. Page 17 is not covered. It's a whole different section. Page 167. Two different entire debate about what does this nation do to improve our health care. Do you have a follow-up?
Yes, sir.
My question or concern is not for those that are uninsured. I don't want the health plan that's offered here. But what I see in that paragraph is that I've got 5 years to be on a plan that's the same as what's in here. And if it does, my plan doesn't meet whatever's in there, then I have to be taxed, even if they're coupled or not.
No. So what he's saying is, if I have a plan that doesn't meet the requirements, I'll end up paying the surcharge unless I'm covered.
I still have a plan.
Right. So if you have what you have under this, and this is a true statement, again, anything's not totally here, but the reality is because the two sectors are uncoupled, if you get employer-based or you buy your own and like what you have, it does not have to do with anything that's under the regulated health care exchange. Two different entities. If you're in the regulated health care exchange, if you don't have health insurance, and that's where you go, then that's what those plans will have to match each other and agree to those conditions. But you'll still have insurance that an insurer can say, if that insurer wants to, it can rescind you. They can say, you've now gotten sick, you've gone over the profitability limit, and we're going to kick you out of insurance. Two different organizations. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you, Congressman Massa. I watched a film on television in which you said, I will vote against the consensus of my constituents adamantly if you feel it is in your best interest. And when I saw that, I got very angry because I assumed you were going to vote for the health bill. I am not in favor of it. And I was very angry. When I went to your meeting last night, I was surprised to find out that you were talking about voting against the health bill. Even so, could you explain your thoughts in terms of that statement?
Absolutely.
Oh, and one other point. You said you can only vote yes or no. Don't you have a third option like the Senate? Can't you vote president?
Yes, that's true. So you can't vote president, but I haven't and I never will, and I can't imagine why I would. So I won't vote president. I'm going to be public out of the room. I will vote adamantly against the interests of my district if I actually think what I'm doing is going to be helpful. Participants said, define interest. I will vote against opinion if I actually believe it will help. It's a very controversial statement. And it cuts to the quick of what a member of Congress is actually charged to do. And this is an argument as old as our republic. The fortunate or unfortunate burden that I have on my shoulders is to weigh all input that I receive, to read the legislation, to get the factual information, and then to do, based on all that input, what I believe will actually help the people I represent. That's a very difficult thing to do. Even when the AMA is screaming at me to vote for this, even when the AARP delivers piles of petitions, even when, frankly, a huge group of individuals in the Rochester area are overwhelmingly in favor of this, and an equal but opposite huge group of people in the southern tier and elsewhere are hugely against it. There is no way for one member of Congress to say, what is the reality of one more than 50% on every single issue? We don't have that capability. Unless you go home and you want to elect somebody who weather vanes and relies on polls. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to rely on polls. And I don't weather vane. I won't do that. You can adamantly disagree with me on things. In fact, whenever you go to Grand Avenue, it's a physical impossibility. I've been married a long time. My spouse has never agreed with me on everything. I'm lucky to break 50% on anything big. And I don't say that just except to illustrate the fact that you either voted against or for me, but in the collective, you hired me in measurement for judgment, to be deliberative, to study, to understand, and to the best of my human ability, to listen. And that's what I'm doing tonight. And that's the best explanation I can give you for what I thought were very heartfelt remarks. I apologize if they weren't clear at the time, but at that moment, I had an awful lot of people screaming and yelling at me to vote for this.
not have coverage. I mean, it is getting, it's just gone beyond. And to people who are so frightened about national health care, I have to say I lived in two countries. One, I lived in Japan for 7 years, and I lived in the UK for 2 years. And when I was in Japan, everybody sort of, if you got sick, you know, you went to the hospital or the clinic and they saw you. They did, at one time I brought in, there was a professor that came to visit and he became ill, so I brought him to the hospital. And he was there, he had a little examination, and he came back to my house. And then about a half hour later, I got a phone call from the hospital. And it turned out that he had type C hepatitis. I guess they were eating some bad sushi or something. And he almost died. So he was in the hospital in Japan for about 3 weeks. And during that time, I had to bring 3 meals a day up to him. I had to wash his linens and bring them back to him, back and forth. But this man lived, and they pay less than half what we pay for health care. And their people live longer. So maybe a nationalized health care is not as scary as it could be. I like the idea of having more choices, but we have to have regulation on people who have pre-existing conditions and when they can change the amount that you have to pay.
Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for coming, and I'm very proud that to have you as a U.S. citizen, to have you employed. I think you're doing great.
Thank you. Thank you. You may be in the minority tonight.
I think we. I, by the way, I'm not a Democrat, and I didn't vote for you, but I still hear it.
That's my parents, by the way.
Thanks, Uncle Larry. Anyways, I had a bunch of things to talk about, but it seems to me like this is about money. And just a little story, and then I'd like to hear your thoughts on something. I work for a multinational company that's based in the U.S., but over the last couple of years, we're in a very, very aggressive and competitive business. We sell electronic components. And it seems to me that the government of the United States, it continues to impose higher taxes and higher restrictions on U.S. companies. And it seems to me that we are putting our U.S. companies, and Eastman Kodak is a perfect example of it, was a monstrous company in Rochester, New York, and now it's a shadow of its former self. And a lot of people are unemployed because of that. But it seems to me that the government of the United States has put a tremendous amount of burden in the form of higher taxes and restrictions that make companies that want to stay in the U.S. and employ people in the U.S. uncompetitive with our most competitive countries abroad, like you mentioned China yourself. They are a competitor. India is a competitor. So I'd like your thoughts on how we can start to make our country a more fertile ground for our companies so that they can stay here or move back here. And that's going to increase the employment that everybody in this room needs so that, by the way, if we have employment, we can start to pay
signed a treaty and agreed before the world to flip their currency. They refused to flip their currency.
over 50% of the competitive advantage that they have over us today. And yet we don't have the spine to stand up and say basta. And we have to do that as a nation, as a Congress, as an executive branch, and as a people. We have to look at our competitor and say, we signed a treaty with you. By the way, I don't like the treaty, but at least, for goodness sakes, we have to live by the rules of that treaty. Because what the macroeconomics tell us, and this is something I've learned, is that as we make less in the United States and send more capital overseas, our currency becomes worth less and less. As another country makes more and has more of our capital, is worth more. And so it becomes more expensive if you come and do business in China. The labor costs increase, the cost of living goes up, and the teeter-totter sways to a more equilibrium or tilts back to the original individual. But as long as they pick their currency to the dollar, and the two are tied at the valuation and steep decline thereon, all you're going to have is a slippery slide for American capital at the rate of about $1.5 billion a day continue to flow to China. And that's exactly what's happening. So that's a very concrete thing we can do that most experts will tell you it's about capital and problem.
Are you going to vote for it?
Absolutely, I'm going to go for it. The challenge is, how do we get that vote to the floor? You know, I can't go to Congress and say, this is what we're going to vote on today. There's a lot that happens to make that happen. There is now a very strong, fair trade alliance, a caucus of members of Congress who believe that if we do not build the things we use in this country, we will no longer exist. We believe that very, very strongly. And we are our voices are stronger. Do you realize today the Department of Defense literally is down to one ammunition manufacturer? One. And when the military actions in Iraq started, we all of a sudden found out we had neither the inventory or the manufacturing capacity. This is an issue of national security in Ukraine, our industrial base, to the point that it's at. So there are things that can be done. And I'm going to do everything I can do. It may not happen tomorrow. It may not happen this year. Reality, it may not happen in this session of Congress. But as long as I have a voice in the matter, I'm going to fight for that. And I wanted to give you a very concrete example.
Thank you for your time. I'm not going to ask you a question, but I am going to give you some facts. The American Medical Association only represents 27% of the USA doctors. The other 73% of medical doctors in the USA are not members of the AMA. On July 15th, the New York Times published an article describing the comments of the AMA delivered to the Senate Finance Committee. Before I quote, introduction.
petitions for national health care policy, who are adamantly and strongly in favor of a single-payer option, who have a very loud voice that's very different than what some members of the AMA said. The AMA was not formed to be a political lobbying organization. It was formed to represent the consensus of where medical specialists, almost always cardiologists, wanted to go. It wasn't until this last change of leadership, for the first time in the history of the AMA, that a pediatrician, coincidentally was also a woman, became the head of the American Medical Association. So I hear what you're saying. They are still pressuring me very hard to vote for this bill. Ma'am, I have never seen a caucus, an association, nor do I ever say with any even implication whatsoever that all doctors are represented by the American Medical Association. Absolutely not. They are still one of the loudest medical voices in the United States. They are. And that's just the reality. Thank you. I mean, I appreciate the time you took to research that. I guess everybody focused on that.